Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another thing where I talk about things. Today I had somebody ask me if I would talk about Let's Plays, how I make them, and stuff like that. There's a lot of different ways to do Let's Plays. It kind of depends on your own personality and what it is that you want to do, but I can talk about some of the technical details and how I set up what I do with my Let's Plays. One of the first things to do is you'll need some kind of recording equipment. You can get some stuff that'll like record your desktop, but you'll find that a great number of programs have an issue with frame rates, where if you start to record, it'll record at like a really low frame rate, like, I don't know, like 10 frames or whatever. I can't remember, like 10 frames per second or something like that. I'm trying to remember what, I tried out a couple free ones. And most of the free ones were kind of terrible. They didn't capture fast enough. And then when you tried to switch between programs, they wouldn't do it. So what I actually use is FRAPS. And FRAPS is good. I don't know a lot about any other programs because I've been using mainly FRAPS. But FRAPS has this issue that I really dislike, where it records everything in .avi format, which, if you're not familiar, is just massive. So if I record for like a half hour, I come back with like 60 gigabytes of footage. So it's not for a small hard drive. If you plan to record like a lot of stuff and then compile it all later, like if you wanted to clear a whole game and then come back, you're gonna need an external hard drive just to store all that video data, unless you've got like a really good hard drive on your computer. So FRAPS has that drawback, but I use FRAPS, and FRAPS you can adjust exactly how fast it's recording, and if you want to see whether or not like it'll show an overlay, or you could hide the overlay, it's up to you, but it'll tell you whether or not like it's gonna be recording with your game, and so on and so forth. FRAPS is very user-friendly, very convenient. You have to pay for it, but it's good software. It's a good thing to get started with. It'll record emulators. The only thing it doesn't record is there are certain windowed games that it won't recognize as like a game. But for that, what you can do is you can switch to desktop mode, Aero desktop mode, and you can tell it just to record your desktop. And that's how I recorded Dwarf Fortress, actually. And so that way, when you're just kind of browsing around, you can actually record anything that you're doing, whatever's on your screen. FRAPS will record it, and there you go. So, recording software, starting off, that's the way to go. As far as, you can use FRAPS for audio, but I personally don't like it. I actually use Audacity, and at the very least, I recommend that you record separately. Because FRAPS will do is it'll record your voice, but it'll mix it in with everything else that's going on. So if you've got background music, stuff going on your computer, Skype noises, it'll just record all of it and blend it all together. And that means that you won't be able to manipulate your voice or do anything with it to really enhance what people are hearing. And that's not good, because you want to do things with your voice. You want to do, you know, your pitch adjustments or whatever if you're doing voices, or your high pass filter, your sound removal. If you've got static on your mic and FRAPS is recording everything and then just mashing it all together, then you're stuck with that static no matter what. So the other thing that I do is I turn on Audacity when I record, and I actually record in post, so this isn't even really an issue. But when I do record as I'm doing something, I run Audacity separately. I never record FRAPS and do Audacity. I never record FRAPS and just rely on FRAPS. I use Audacity for all my vocal stuff. So that way, anyway, like, you've got your vocals on a separate track, and you can import that, and you can maybe like slide a little bit to the right ear if you like, because that sounds happier. That, you know, it's better because you process more speaking with your left side of your brain, and so on and so forth. So yeah, record audio with like a separate program like Audacity, which is free, and video with FRAPS, and there you go. You've got your basics. The thing that somebody asked me though is they asked me like, how do I decide what games I'm gonna do a Let's Play on? And additionally, how do you avoid stuff like content ID claims? And for the first one, it's easy. The second question is a little bit harder, because content ID is a horrible, horrible beast. As you're aware, it just caught the Mentally Advanced series, and so it's not a question that's easily answered. It's very political. But as for how I decide on what I want to do when I do a Let's Play, I actually look at games that I used to love, or that I know something about, or maybe I recently downloaded and had a good time, and there'll be something that I want to say. And for everyone who does a Let's Play, it's really kind of up to you how you want to do it. Because if you're a comedian, then of course you want to tell jokes. So you want to do your Let's Play and you'll make a lot of humor about the game. But if you just want to talk, if you want to analyze the games, then you've got to analyze the games. And if you just want to do a running commentary and use the games as background, then it doesn't really matter. Because at that point, you're relying solely on your commentary and the games are just background. So the way you handle your Let's Play depends on you personally and where you feel your strengths are as a speaker or as a commentator or as a funny guy. It just depends on what you want to do. I do the characters because the characters are what I've been doing on the channel. And I like to roleplay. I have a good time. So even when I do the tutorial, I don't do the tutorial as myself. I do it as Uris Goldbar. Or we do the Let's Plays where I play multiple characters and then I can do a little bit of analysis and I can argue with myself. And I've gotten some emails that people really like that because if I get too one-sided, then I can have another character come in and disagree. And so that's a thing that people like. As far as choosing games, like I say, I just kind of go with games that I'm familiar with, stuff that I really like. The MechWarrior 4 game I really, really used to like. And that one was... It's got a slightly more interesting take, though, because I didn't want to just do the same story that the game goes through. It's fine by itself, but I didn't want to have just Rey by herself shouting at everybody. Or you can't even roleplay that, because the main character, Ian, responds to people. He talks. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted to insert myself into the game. I am the commander. I am in control of Ian. So what I did with that one is I actually just deleted the full audio. Like, there's no audio on that, and I recreate it. Like, I went out and I got some cans for the stomps. What I did is I think I slammed my car door, and I got some aluminum cans, and I crushed them, and I did some other stuff. I made some other banging noises. I think there's like a light explosion sound like I found on the internet, and I altered that up a bunch, and so basically I just mashed it all together, and so now when you hear this stomp, it sounds like a big mechanical leg stepping down on the ground. And so then I go and I look in the video, and every time the robot twists or moves, like left or right, I set down a stomp. And it's about as tedious as it sounds. It's actually, it can be a little bit time consuming. But sometimes if I'm just running, and I'm like running consistently a lot, then the robot is moving back and forth very consistently, so I can kind of copy and paste for long stretches. I just have to keep an eye out and make sure that I don't accidentally copy and paste over a point where I like pause for like a second or something like that. But the one that's more complicated has been the laser sounds and things like that. For the lasers, what I've been doing is I've been getting a pair of Southern Comfort bottles from... I really haven't been drinking very much anymore. Ken's asked me to quit drinking, and so I've basically quit drinking. But I've got some old Southern Comfort bottles, and they've got all these ridges on them. So what I do is, like, I'll rub the bottles together, or I've got, like, a knife, and I'll take the knife and I'll rub it along the, like, what does it say on the side? Like, I think, I don't know, maybe it just says Southern Comfort. But anyway, I just rub it along the glass letters, and it makes kind of a high-pitched zing noise. And so I use that as my lasers, and so that's how I get my pulse lasers and everything else. I do a lot of effects with that. And similar stuff with the Gauss cannons, I think. Car door slams, small explosion noises, things like that. Just a lot of really bizarre ways to come up with noises to replace it. Of course, the only problem with that is that I suffer the hear no evil, speak no evil syndrome, where, like, if I don't see something on screen, then it doesn't get heard. I don't know that it's going on. So, like, we'll have times occasionally where I'll be, like, recording and I'll get all my editing done. And then I start doing my vocal stuff, and I'll see, like, a laser fly by. And there's no sound effect for the lasers, so then I've got to go back and I've got to, like, add in lasers and stuff like that where there aren't any. So occasionally when I forget myself, I've got to go back and do a little bit more post-editing. So the MechWarrior series, it actually takes a lot of editing. It's not too bad. I mean, like, it's doable. I started off doing it and I was like, this is kind of, like, manageable. And yeah, so this is not something that I would do for every single game. Maybe for some games. But also, too, I've got a sound pack because I do the Monday Music stuff. There are sound packs that you can buy and download, and they're royalty-free. Like, once you buy them, there's no royalties to pay on them. And one of them came with a bunch of, like, gun noises. And so that's where I get some of the, like, I stack those gun noises on with other things. Like, I've got a machine gun noise, and I think I spread it out a little bit and then deepen the bass to make it sound like a heavier kind of weapon. Stuff like that. So those are handy. Like, if you can find packs like that have, like, background noises that you would use and things, those are really good for starting with a convincing bass and then building into something that sounds like what you want to do. So that's how I do the MechWarrior stuff. The other ones are pretty straightforward. I mean, I've just been doing everything else. If you guys have seen the Legacy of Kain Let's Plays, the Soul Reaver 2 Let's Plays, I've been chopping up the cutscenes. And this, I thought, this is good for two reasons. The first is that Soul Reaver 2 is very story-based, and so I didn't want to spoil the story for anybody who still was interested in playing the games. The games are pretty affordable on Steam now. You can go check them out and play them at your leisure. I think they're like $5 or something like that. It's pretty affordable. $5 or $10, I don't know. But yeah, if you wanted to go play it, you could. But I didn't want to spoil the story for it, because as you guys saw as I played through, the puzzles are kind of nice, but the combat system is really weak, and the game doesn't have a whole lot of replayability. These were the major critiques that the game had, and they're very valid critiques. So if I spoil the story, then there's really no reason for you guys to go and play it on your own. So I constructed a kind of a similar but stupider story using our own characters. And in that way, you know, it makes it more interesting, not only for you guys, because then you've got the comedy elements and stuff like that, but also for people who have already seen the game, because now they get to see the game through a slightly different lens, through the lens of an outsider who watched the game and thought to himself, like, wow, Kane's a really hilarious guy, when I was clearly not supposed to think that Kane was hilarious. I just kind of think that he is. So, that's another thing that you can try. The only trouble is, the other reason I did that was because I was pretty confident that would avoid Content ID, because Content ID has been in the past somewhat susceptible to alterations to videos. Very early on, if you just did a mirror image of, say, like Harry Potter, then you could upload the full Harry Potter movie, and people used to do this, in fact, and you would just have Harry Potter in reverse, and that would be like, or just in mirror image, and that would bypass the Content ID system. Well, the Content ID system got wise, so now it catches people who flip the mirror, who do the mirror image. The image trick, I thought, would be something that they wouldn't really catch, because if you're chopping up the images so much, then in theory, there's no way that you can be getting anything close to the full experience. I mean, like, even if I gutted all the audio and then replaced, like, I got burned on the Mentally Advanced series, so, like, basically what YouTube accused me of doing was completely ripping the Mentally Advanced series. They didn't give any assumption of fair use. It's very much an attack first. Nope, they didn't really ask questions later. It's just sort of like an attack. It's just attack software. They just attack people. So, it's very strange, because even if I had completely reposted the whole My Little Pony show, and what I had done is I had gutted the audio and then just used, like, clips from the show and then, I don't know, like captions or something like that to let you know what audio was in, it would really be kind of a pale, just stupid... I mean, like, I don't know if you could even make... You could almost make an argument for transformation on that. I mean, you'd probably lose, but it just goes to show how much, like, all the it would really demonstrate how much all, like, the musical cues and subtle little audio subtle visual gags and everything plays into how well a cartoon is made. I mean, if you used it to be educational, that would be, like, a completely valid thing to do, to take, like, here's a screenshot, just a still image, you know, captions. You lose the you lose the voice acting, you lose everything. So, I thought for sure that Content ID would not get so specific that it would hunt down, like, image mashups like that. But sure enough, that's what they're doing now. So I don't know how strict they're going to get with that. It worries me, because I feel like if they keep getting more strict with it, then pretty soon, yeah, even if you just show, like, a clip from a show, or, like, just a screen cap, you know, then Content ID is going to show up, and they're going to be like, oh, did you talk about a show? Your revenue now belongs to the owners of that show. And pretty soon, like, there won't be any point to talking about anything, because Content ID will just destroy any kind of fair use that exists. If it's not put together with completely original artwork, that is. Until, of course, they make Content ID sophisticated enough to attack original artwork. I'm sure they're working on it. But yes, that was one of the questions they asked me, is how do you avoid Content ID? And the trouble is that the question now comes down to politics. You have to look at the individual game companies and figure out what they're doing, where they are, and what their beliefs are about seizing ad revenue on YouTube. And some companies are very much against it. Like, when they had that big rash of Content ID seizures, where these royalty collection companies were grabbing everyone's videos, including the videos that belonged to the game developers who were advertising for their own games. There were some developers who got really upset, and they put out statements against it. They basically verified that a Let's Play is a really good source of advertising, and it's a really positive thing, and it's really helped the gaming industry. It's been good for a lot of games. But there are companies, though, like Nintendo, which has been struggling financially, and they're being very opportunistic. They realize that if they use Content ID to claim these Let's Plays, that they can pull in potentially, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars, maybe even millions, if their games are very popular. So it's hard to say, like, if a company's gonna be opportunistic, they're gonna be opportunistic. And YouTube will side with them. Their whole system kind of... It's weird. It's like, you can't really say it doesn't, like, promote piracy, but it does really promote... Like, if you assume that everyone who's doing a Let's Play has a good fair use claim, then technically giving all their ad revenue to Nintendo, it's kind of like piracy. It's weird, though, because copyright law is so convoluted. But basically, though, yeah, the opportunism is something that you have to look out for. To know whether or not you can even make a Let's Play of a game, you have to look up the politics of that company. And for a company like Nintendo, I would just not even bother. Like, just don't even do it. It's stupid. It's worthless. They'll seize your game. They'll seize your footage. They'll seize your revenue. There's not really a very functional dispute process. I mean, like, for one game, sure. Like, if you post a game and you plan to post, like, one game every month, and YouTube and all their royalty collection Nintendo and all their royalty collection agencies are going to snag it, then you can dispute that thing, like, once a month. But if you post, like, 80 videos, and all 80 of them get captured by Content ID, it's basically purgatory. They're never coming back. You've lost them. Nintendo's going to claim the revenue on those indefinitely. Or worse, if they decide to flip it over to, like, a global ban, then you just lose your internet. Or, for goodness sake, you lose your YouTube. You don't lose your internet until Google installs Google Fiber, and then you lose connection to all their services because Google's very, very strict about this sort of thing. So, yeah, there are websites, though. There's a Reddit page, I believe, that actually was keeping track of which companies are really hard on Let's Plays and which companies are not. So if you're thinking about doing a Let's Play, I would advise that you go to that website or just seek out any kind of information that you can. And like I say, if it comes back, if there's a blatant no or a blatant this company seizes revenue, this company seizes your videos, then just don't talk about their videos. Don't do reviews on them. Don't do anything. Let those companies have their way. This is what they want. It's shooting themselves in the foot, and they know it. But companies like Nintendo are trying to make ends meet, and they're trying to demonstrate to shareholders that they can make ends meet. And so they don't care. They're thinking in the short term. They're trying to get the ad revenue up in the short term. And especially, this was kind of funny because Nintendo was encouraging people to do Let's Plays before they seized everybody's Let's Plays. That's what's really horrible, is they were like, everybody go out and do Let's Plays. Send us an email with your best Let's Play. And so people did that, and then Nintendo came around and just, like, seized everyone's... Oh, we own those now! Those belong to Nintendo! Thank you! We're gonna start pulling in ad revenue. So, yeah. There's nothing stopping them from doing that. They can pull the rug out from underneath you. Be aware. However, it's really hard for them to capture actual gameplay footage. So if you're nervous about it, if you don't know, if the company seems kind of, like, uncertain, then for cutscenes is what they really upload. So if you, like, skip cutscenes, then you can get away with that. Only problem is that sometimes if you skip cutscenes, then it becomes very confusing. The game really relies on the cutscenes to get from point A to point B, and then it's very silly. So, yeah, YouTube is just kind of its own weird, convoluted, like, the law actually makes no difference. I could go on about copyright law, I have in the past, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter on YouTube. Whatever happens will happen, and that's just kind of how it is. So, there's no rules to follow, just be aware that, yeah, it gets silly. What else? Give me a second, let me check the questions. Ah, okay, so, back again. Another question that they just asked is music, does it ever get captured by Content ID? And yes, absolutely, the music is one of the ways that stuff gets captured by Content ID. If you would like to gut the audio from your videos, that's probably a good idea. You don't want to show off that game's music, because if they seize your revenue, and so on and so forth. I have the tendency to want to belabor on about the Content ID system, because I don't like it. But the other question that the person asked is, are ROM hacks, like the Pony Fantasy series, are those good ideas for Let's Plays? And actually, yes, they are. I think that those are really some of the better ideas for Let's Plays, because when people start to make, like, really big alterations to a game, you start to notice how those alterations really affect gameplay. And it becomes kind of interesting to go through and say to yourself, like, oh, so they did this, or they made these tweaks, and now the game handles totally differently. Like, sometimes it just totally breaks the game. Pony Fantasy did this a little bit, where they changed stuff around, and they made it to where, like, Apple Bloom had the Tools command, where previously she only had the Steel command, and then Celestia had her own, like, borked thing, and she... So, like, Edgar, the Edgar character, who originally had Tools, went from being, like, a really good character in the early game to being, like, the worst character, and Celestia never caught up. Like, she never caught up from losing the Tools command. And it was funny because he changed it to where only unicorns could have magic. And then you got, like, Luna, who was just a bruiser from the start. Like, she was really strong starting off because she was based on Sabin, who was, like, the brawler monk. And so she had magic, and she had, like, punching power. And so she wound up being, like, one of the most overpowered characters in the game because she had access to just more tools. But magic by itself wasn't enough to make a character like Twilight actually shine, because magic wasn't really, it's really not that good. It was kind of like useful for utility, but that's why everybody could kind of learn it, because it's just like your characters became more versatile with magic. They didn't really become over the top powerful. So Pony Fantasy created a lot of opportunities to discuss the game design. And it really highlighted some of the reasons why they did certain things in the original game. Same with as they changed the dialogue, like with a really extensive hack that changes a lot of the original dialogue. If you know the original game really well, and you go through and you play, like for me, for Pony Fantasy, then you can see how those changes to dialogue change a lot of things. It alters a lot of things. Like in the original Final Fantasy VI, the scene with Bannon says, like, they want to take Terra to go negotiate with the Espers. And this is their whole plan, is they think that Terra can talk to the Espers and they can get the Espers in on the war. And with the Espers' help, they'll win the fight against Gestahl. In Pony Fantasy, they're saying, like, hey, Twilight, you're really magically powerful. Do you think you could just defeat all of Discord's army? Or all of Gilda's army? All of Gilda's army? Do you think that would happen? And it didn't make any sense, because Twilight by herself was not that strong, and the answer was really, like, no. By herself, she couldn't bring down an empire. Maybe she could assassinate Gilda, but that would be it. So, just that those kind of tweaks, like, they change the whole meaning and intention. It makes the characters go from being, like, kind of benign and sort of sensible to being almost, like, malevolent and a little bit stupid. Because, like, when your whole plan is just, oh, let's get this girl to kill everyone else who has the same gift that she does, even though there's no evidence that her gift is stronger. It's just not as sensical. So, actually, people have asked me if I want to do Pony Earthbound. And I've played Earthbound, but I never beat the game. I got as far as to the cults, like the blue cult, I think is what it is. And that's as far as I ever got in the game. So I don't know enough about the game that I could play a hack and then be able to say, like, oh, look at all these dialogue changes. This is changing completely the meaning of what's going on. I'm not even sure if Earthbound was that intensive in terms of story base. It was kind of a quirky, fun game, as far as I recall. It wasn't so much like, I don't know, there were some interesting elements, but it was just the game had a lot of character and like a lot of personality, and maybe not the best story, but just a lot of individual flair. So, still though, I mean, like, if you wanted to play a pony version of Earthbound, then you could kind of go and you could look at how changing everyone into ponies really alters that individual flair. And it's actually, it's almost kind of educational. Like I say, that by itself is transformative enough that it gives you a lot to commentate on, it gives you a lot to discuss. If they change balance elements, then you can talk about how it affects gameplay. So yeah, hacks are a really good way to actually do Let's Plays. They're a really good reason. Especially because people may not have played the hacks, but they played the original game, and so they might find it very interesting to look at the game from this completely different perspective, or to see how the game changes when you do certain things. So, yeah, I think that those are really good. I believe that's it for the list of questions. Like I say, everything really kind of depends on your own style, your own personality, and what it is that you want to do. Your software also has to be decent. I mean, I've seen Let's Plays that were really very amusing because, for example, there would be a guy who would use, like, a really slow frame rate. Or there was one, actually, this... I'd seen other YouTubers make fun of this guy because he did this, but his own computer couldn't actually run the emulator very fast, and so he was playing the game, and it was recording in real time, but the guy was, like, playing it, like, you know, 10 frames per second, and it was just, it was like Mario 64 or something like that. It was, I can't remember what they named it, like, Let's Watch Slow Motion Mario N64. And so it was, like, the most, just, it was insane. Because it was just like there was so little action as far as the game was concerned, but they just went with it. So unless you want something like that, then yeah, you do have to go ahead and do a little research on the software. Like I said, I use FRAPS. I wish I knew more about other software, but FRAPS is one of the most user-friendly things out there as far as I'm aware, and it'll get you what you're looking for at the expense of just your hard drive being full. But anyway, though, I hope that's a good take on it. Let's Plays are very, very, very saturated. So one thing to be aware of is that if you're going to do Let's Plays, they won't probably take off like they used to back in the old days. Fun fact, the only reason why PewDiePie got huge is because of a glitch in the Google system. Let's Plays are funny because they go on for like 30 minutes, maybe. If the guy's just doing running commentary and he's not like doing any post-editing or anything. He just plays the game and then just kind of like mumbles over the game, and PewDiePie, I think, had a lot of personality when he did his stuff, which is how he got big. But his real secret was that he was doing this and Google was actually looking for videos that were long and being watched throughout that whole length, and they would take that, and on the basis of that, they would promote his videos. So like, for example, our videos that we do, like the Rainbow Dash Presents stuff, where we have like a 20 minutes, half hour, whatever, a video, and everyone watches all the way through that, YouTube really likes that, and so they promote that. Only trouble is those take us like a year to do, so we can't really post a whole ton of those. It's very impractical. We don't have the capacity to do stuff like that. We can't make full-blown cartoons with just a two-man team. So Let's Plays, though, can do that, and so PewDiePie was doing this, like, you know, every single day. He was producing a new video, and it was 30 minutes long, and people would watch him all the way through, and so he would get promoted on YouTube for every single video, which got him more views and more subscribers, and he grew and grew and grew. And then he moved from country to country, and every time he moved to a new country, they would start promoting him in that country. And so then he started in Sweden, then he moved to like France, and then he went to the US. And so he got promoted all over Europe and in the US. And that's how he got so big, is that it actually wasn't because Let's Plays are just like the most fun thing ever to watch. It's because of YouTube's system. They just advertised the heck out of PewDiePie. In fact, I don't know if they're still doing this, but I think now that if you make an account, I believe that you automatically like all of PewDiePie's videos, or if you subscribe to him. There's something weird, like Google's just gotten really weird with PewDiePie. I don't even know, I sometimes wonder what PewDiePie thinks of his own success. Kenza was telling me she thought that he got a little, there was a period where he got a little bit testy with his fans. Like it got to be to where it seemed like he didn't want to do it, or he didn't want to do Let's Plays all the time or something, and his fans were like, no, PewDiePie, this is what we came for. And then PewDiePie got a little frustrated. I don't think he ever really came out and like fought with people, but maybe, I don't know. I don't know a whole lot about PewDiePie, but Kenza just was telling me about this, is that he got a little sassy with his fans for a little while. Then he quit doing that, and now he just kind of does it professionally. So I really wonder, like, I wonder about guys like PewDiePie who got into that sort of thing and never expected to get big. And so it's something you've got to do for love, though, because after that got big with PewDiePie, I'm pretty sure they fixed the algorithms to where they won't do that anymore. So you're basically not going to get promoted. You're not going to get catapulted to success from doing a Let's Play. It's not a magic wand. It's very bizarre when it did work. But it was through the system, not because it's like a revolutionary style of gameplay. So yeah, so if you're doing it just because it's fun. Do it because the way I think of it is it's like playing a game and you know you have a friend over and it's like a single player game and your friend kind of interacts with you by like pointing out stuff or you know, like do they just kind of enjoy talking to you while you're playing? Things like that. That's kind of what it is. So if you want to do a Let's Play, think of it as like, I'm, you know, these are my friends on the internet. Kind of like, it's just kind of like a friendly deal. So be friendly with it, have fun, be laid back, just have a good time. And that's the best way to go. So, yes, I hope that is an informative take on the whole Let's Play thing. And I will catch you guys later.